buy. You know, this is the crazy thing. And you should never have to sell because land is a commodity and it's getting more and more prevalent. And
I'll tell you, this is John Fitzgerald. He is a property investor and developer from the Gold Coast, Australia. He is also the author of the book, 7 Steps to Wealth, The Vital Difference Between Property and Real Estate. The book, now in its 8th edition, outlines a strategy for accumulating wealth by purchasing increasing amounts of real estate over time. The book is a good introduction to the real estate market, teaching some of the fundamentals, such as the fact that land appreciates in value while buildings depreciate in value. While it is only a short book, I was able to learn a lot of new information about the particulars of purchasing property in Australia. On the whole, I agree with a large percentage of the book. However, there were a few things that I found myself questioning. Rather than summarizing everything that I agree with in the book, I have focused my comments in this summary on the parts that I see as problematic. The core of my concern is that John outlines what I see as an extremely risky investment strategy, while labeling it as a low-risk strategy. In my opinion, it is extremely risky to invest more than 100% of your wealth into a single investment category, in a single country, in a single city, and often on a single plot of land. The cost of diversification has dramatically reduced in recent years with the advent of index funds of various kinds. So it also seems like an unnecessary risk. It might be true that you can achieve a slightly higher rate of return using this strategy. However, this is offset by the level of risk that you take on. I feel as though the book is missing an honest discussion of risk, and consequently, the discussion of diversification is also missing.
Are set to take a beating with analysts forecasting a dramatic drop in property values right across the country. And Nine's finance editor Ross Greenwood joins us now.
In 2019, the guaranteed returns associated with the Australian housing market have been shown to be not so guaranteed. Many fear that following the Financial Services Royal Commission, banks will be forced to lift their lending standards, making it much harder for people to get credit. And with less credit, house prices are likely to fall dramatically.
Overpricing. Yes. Significant overpricing. And so we know that housing became unaffordable for many people.
Of course, I don't know how things will play out in the long run. However, I don't think it is helpful to think about the expected returns in a binary fashion. In other words, house prices will either go up or down. Rather, you should think about it in probabilistic terms. Of course, John's expected probability distribution for Australian house prices might be very different to my own. However, it will almost certainly assign some probability to a negative return. If this is the case, this should be built into the investment strategy through some form of diversification. One consideration that I think is overlooked is the problem of survivorship bias. When the author talks about his numerous clients' success, there is no mention of the number of people who went bankrupt following this strategy. This is especially problematic when he is talking about the average performance of his portfolio of investors. This causes him to overestimate the historical performance of his clients.
What they want.
Relatedly, when he does talk about investment failures, there is usually a rational explanation for why that case was not representative of the whole. He will very easily pull together a post hoc justification to explain where they went wrong. It is very easy to know what a bad investment is when you are looking back on the past. Everyone can do that. If you could reliably predict which were the houses which were bad investments, why couldn't you short some index of those houses? I think, in truth, the failure of many of his clients would have been due to random variations that are in truth unpredictable. Random variations in housing prices and other factors such as your personal income are inevitable. You just have to build that into your investment strategy. Obviously, an honest conversation about the level of risk in this investment strategy is not going to be included in a book of this nature, because it is essentially marketing material for his business. However, it should be. And the fact that it is not talked about in more detail is a large red flag in my mind. Another thing that I think is important to consider is the efficient market hypothesis. The idea that the price of any given investment, for example, a house, reflects all information on the value of that investment. For example, if a house is close to public transport, good schools, has a favourable land ratio, all of that information is already reflected in the current price of the house, adjusted for risk, of course. As such, it should be impossible to outperform the overall market through expert property selection or market timing. And the only way an investor can obtain a higher return is by purchasing riskier investments. However, I do accept that property markets are a lot less efficient than stock markets, given that people are often buying property to live in rather than as rational investments. Nonetheless, I think the degree to which one can just pick houses that will have higher rates of return is overstated in the book. A good rule of thumb for investing is that there is no such thing as a free lunch. Whenever an investment strategy promises very high rates of return, you should always ask, what am I missing? More often than not, the answer is risk. One person that has influenced my thinking a lot in this space is Nassim Nicholas Taleb. He's a former trader and risk analyst whose work focuses on the problems of randomness, probability, and uncertainty. If you haven't already read some of his work, I would highly recommend it. I would most strongly recommend Fooled by Randomness. However, The Black Swan and Anti-Fragile are both relevant to this issue. Taken together, if you are thinking about purchasing property, 7 Steps to Wealth is a book well worth reading. However, I would caution against using the advice in the book as a standalone investment strategy.